Well, hello, Johan. Super, super to have you with us. It's my immense pleasure to welcome you as one of the most internationally recognized scientists for your work on planetary boundaries and the need for urgent climate action. We've heard already from Amina Mohammed and Mark Carney on these global challenges that somewhat lurk behind the pandemic. To you, we're seeking your, and we can say, sobering direction on behalf of the scientific community on why planetary sustainability needs to be the finance sector's concern, and why they should be focusing here as we dig out from today's economic and health crisis and we start to look forward towards a more resilient future and essentially building back better, to use the UN description, and essentially focusing on some environment of society's greatest challenges, the Sustainable Development Goals, Paris Climate Agreement, and more. So with that, Johan, if I can hand it over to you, and thank you for your participation.
So can you hear me? I'm not able to.
Yes. Yes, we can. Please go ahead, Johan. No, now we can't.
To mute.
There we are.
Virtual. It works now?
You're good now.
Okay. It looks as if I'm still muted. Okay. So the red thread in science, as I think we all are aware, is that we've underestimated risk. We are today scientifically forced to ask the following question: Are we at risk of destabilizing the entire Earth system? You may have seen the science that came out from colleagues at my own institute, the Potsdam Institute, just last week, that the latest science on the Amazon, one of the global commons regulating not only life support systems, but also the stability of the Earth system, has now been subject to so much reduction in precipitation and rainfall that 40% of the rainforest can exist in both rainforest state and move into an irreversible savanna trajectory. 2 weeks before that, colleagues showed in their latest climate runs that West Antarctica, in a paper led by Julius Garb et al., that at global warming levels of 2 degrees Celsius warming, so where we are heading potentially just in 20, 30 years' time, West Antarctica is committed to long-term partial collapse. The Antarctic ice sensitivity is actually, in its latest assessments, 1.3 meters of global sea level rise for every 1 degree warming between where we are now and 2 degrees Celsius. If we pass 2 degrees Celsius, that doubles to 2.4 meters for every new degree of warming between 2 and 6 degrees. Just to show the drama of the commitments for future generations. In November 2019, just before COVID-19, Tim Lenton et al. Did a 10-year summary of the tipping elements in the Earth system, showing that 9 of the 15 known big systems that regulate the state of the Earth system are on the move. They're showing signs of slowing down or higher variability, potentially approaching tipping points. This is not a result from individual research groups. You have the United in Science report published 1 year ago showing from WMO and IPCC and Future Earth that the Red Embers assessment shows that over the last 20 years, the more we learn of the Earth system, the higher is the risk. In fact, 20 years ago, we thought that the risk for catastrophic change was potentially at 5 to 6 degrees Celsius warming. It's now down to 2 degrees Celsius warming. We have true reason to start considering declaring a state of planetary emergency. Now, this also requires from us a new way of thinking about time, which connects to the financial sector. We focused all our attention in economics and investments on impact time, something happening 50 years away or 100 years away. Now we have to understand that the key time horizon that really is valued and should be valued in finance and risk is commitment time, not impact time. We know today from science in the latest assessment that over the next 10 to 20 years, we enter the phase of commitment time. This is the moment where we'll be pressing on buttons or determining whether or not we will press on buttons of irreversible trajectories that would take us to multi-meter sea level rise and irreversible changes in life support systems across the world affecting millions. As far as we know, that's why we're entering the decisive decades of humanity. Another key insight is that we also know today scientifically that whether or not we will succeed in delivering the Paris Climate Agreement is no longer about decarbonizing the world's energy system. It is equally important to transform the world's food system and maintain the carbon sinks in natural ecosystems. Paris is a global sustainability transformation. It requires development, equitable prosperity within a stable and resilient Earth system. Planetary boundaries provide the scientific targets to define that safe operating space. Science can today deliver the guardrails that can guide the financial sector in its investments into the future. There's so much at stake here. We have burnt fossil fuels, adding something like 280 billion tons of carbon into the atmosphere, causing the 1.2 degrees Celsius warming so far, and all the dramatic impacts from droughts and floods and strengthened hurricanes and forest fires we're seeing in the world today. Can you imagine just the irrecoverable carbon in some of the already today humanly intensively managed natural ecosystems host more than 260 billion tons of carbon, almost the same amount that we've been burning over the past 150 years. We cannot allow ourselves to lose these fluxes. These are marshes, rainforest, temperate forests, Siberian tundra, systems that help us to keep the resilience in the entire Earth system. So the conclusion, dear friends, is that we need an urgent global transformation in order to stand a chance to deviate away from a drift of the Earth system far from what can support the world as we know it. Science-based targets for Earth is one step beyond climate. Now we're moving from SBTI to setting science-based targets for land, for biodiversity, for fresh water, for pollutants, for stable oceans. We can actually do this scientifically. It's quite exciting to see how in the run-up to Kunming and the CBD meeting in China next year, we're seeing more and more evidence that if we need net zero future for carbon, we also need net zero future for loss of nature to keep the life support systems intact. These are supported and bundled by enormous synergies and potential trade-offs. COVID-19, we know, is a zoonosis. It's a virus spillover from wild animals, probably via domestic animals, propelling itself in a hyper-connected world to the biggest disaster in the world economy since the 1930s. We know that the best way to build resilience against future pandemics is to invest in nature, keeping natural habitats intact, building resilience in our water, food systems, natural ecosystems to avoid these trajectories to occur in the future. We also know that the virus, COVID-19, is a lung infection. So the best way to be humanly resilient is to have strong lung capacities. For that, you want to breathe clean air. So decarbonizing the energy system gives us more resilient human communities to be better prepared for future lung infections. Same goes with food. We know that 10 to 11 million people die prematurely every year because of obesity, non-communicable disease like heart and different forms of non-communicable diseases. Investing in health is a way of building resilience to a more shaky future. What's the grand window to close? Well, we have to recognize global systemic risks. The financial sector is best placed to measure and value risk. But I think that the most important is to combine that risk assessment with the evidence that investing in sustainability makes economic sense. It's not about protecting nature anymore. It's about building security, prosperity, and equity, and better competitive industry and economic development. That is the new agenda, sustainability as modernity and the pathway to the future. I would argue that you in the financial sector are the most important actors to really, you know, determine where the fluxes are, but also tell the story of opportunity. With that, I hand it back to you. Thank you.